Say that again.
Yeah, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail. It's just, you know, DA and we just, as an organization, decided that we needed to change. And Pete's a fantastic coach. Been with us for, you know, 17, 18 years, done a lot of really, really good things, but we just felt like we needed to change.
What about the offense kind of, you feel like, dictated that change?
Yeah, I just, you know, again, we just felt like we can perform better and we needed a change in that area.
Mickey, would that be along the same lines that Coach Burns was a wide receiver? You thought there should have been more development?
Yeah, again, I think, you know, I'm not going to get into anything specific because I think all three of those guys are good coaches, did a lot of good things, but I think in the assessment we needed, you know, felt like we needed something a little different.
Mickey, what was your overall take on this, the season as a whole?
Yeah, it looks, I think that, I think our expectations were higher collectively. You know, we had some games that slipped away from us and a couple we didn't perform in well, and just, you know, it's a variety of reasons, that's all. So when you look at a season, you look at how you perform, there's so many variables, and, you know, it just wasn't good enough, ultimately. We didn't achieve what our expectations.
Mickey, this is three straight years now of missing the playoffs, and there was, a study posted yesterday that you guys had the oldest roster in the entire NFL based on snaps played this year. Is there a feeling of you guys were going for a certain window with a lot of core players and the state of the NFC South, and maybe that needs to be rethought now?
No, I see some of those stats sometimes, and I think you got to look beyond just whatever the raw number is. You got to look at, you know, the core of your team. And look, a couple guys can skew that. So I don't look at that like we're an old team. I really don't.
As far as the development with Trevor Penning.
Yeah.
Do you think it could be maybe take the same course as Andrews Pete, where I don't know if he's going to work out a tackle, but we think he can be a starting offensive lineman. He might have to play guard. I know back in the day, like Jim Dombrowski, first-round draft pick from Virginia, that never really worked out a tackle, was an outstanding guard. And so could that happen?
Yeah, I think with any offensive lineman, you know, and there's some other positions where this is applicable too. You know, you make an assessment and a vision of where you have them, and if that doesn't work out, you know, you look at their strengths and weaknesses and say, maybe we can place them there. I think with Trevor, look, we didn't do him any favors. You know, he comes as a rookie, he gets hurt, you know, he misses 10 games. We play him the back half of that season, primarily in a jumbo role, and he did some good things, and then he gets hurt. And he has no off season, and then we throw him in there as the starter, you know, week one. I think a lot of that falls on us in terms of, you know, where he was and what he was ready to do. And so I'm still pretty high on Trevor Penning. I think we all are, but we recognize that, hey, look, we've got to do a better job in terms of development and preparing him to be ready. And I think we'll do that this off season. I think we'll have a good plan for him. Yeah. Look, here's what I think. I think sometimes, you know, the easy thing to do, the lazy thing to do, is look at the results of a season and say, it's the coach's fault or it's the quarterback's fault. I think oftentimes you have to look beyond that. I was prepared for this question, right? Chuck Knoll, his first 3 years, Hall of Fame coach, he was 1-13, 5-9, 6-8. But they recognize that this guy's a good football coach, right? Bill Belichick, here's his first three seasons, 6-10, 7-9, 7-9. Tom Landry, 0-11, 4-9, 5-8, 4-10, 5-8. Hall of Fame coaches, all of them. Bill Walsh, first year, 2-14, second year, 6-10. So I think the easy thing to do is just look at the results and say, oh, no, we've got to have a change. You got to look beyond that. You know, what are the reasons why we were 9-8 instead of, you know, 13-4. And look, it's collective. It's the players. It's the coaches. It's me. It's our personnel staff, our roster. It's variables sometimes that we don't have any control of. And so my assessment is Dennis Allen is a good coach.
Mickey,
And again, you know, with Sean Payton, we went 10-6 the first year, but then we were 7-9, 8-8, and I heard some of the same noise. But at the time, I knew we had a good football coach. And so I think sometimes the hard thing to do is to be patient and recognize your other shortcomings and get those fixed, and that's what we're doing.
Can you spend some talk about, like, the culture a little bit? What are some of the things with the culture that you feel like you
could
change?
Yeah, I don't like the word culture necessarily because I think, look, we got really good guys, willing. And I think, look, a lot of things that I said to the players, I'm sure you guys are aware of it, were for the players' ears only. I think collectively, though, that everybody, you know, if you ask, do you want to win? Everybody stands up. They raise their hand, right? If everybody says, what are you willing to do what's necessary to win? They all raise their hand. But sometimes we're not doing the things that are necessary to win. And that's on me. That's on me 100%. I've got to hold our guys to a standard to do the things necessary to win. And I think that I probably let that slip a little bit over the last few years. And so we're gonna get that recalibrated. And so that's my message to our entire building. It's not just to the players or just the coaches. It's to our entire building.
Is some of that stuff like extra homework to study and taking care of the body?
Well, there's a lot of things. And I think I was pretty specific about what those things are, but that's really for their ears, not for your ears.
Can you elaborate at all about how it's on you if you don't deal with the players day-to-day?
Excuse me?
Well, you said that it's on you, but since you're not the one dealing with the players day-to-day and kind of, you know, looking over their...
Well, look, I'm accountable for that. You know, we have a certain standard here, and look, some of it's out of our control. You know, COVID, league rules, there's things that are out of our control, but that doesn't mean that we can't have a standard that we set. And look, it starts with me, it does. And certainly our head coach and our coaching staff and all the people in the building are responsible for it, but it begins with me.
Mickey, I don't know if this has been addressed, but going back, talking about, if you don't like the word culture, but as far as the camaraderie amongst teammates.
Mm-hmm. No.
So that didn't come into play. So what's like you score a touchdown, you get extra 100,000 or that
wasn't. No, look, I think that this has been talked about way too much, frankly. Look, I get it. Players wanted to do a favor for you know, one of their teammates and probably didn't think it completely through. I would rather we not do that. But there was no underlying message to that. It was all exactly what it appeared to be. They're trying to do a favor for a teammate, get him a touchdown, and I just wasn't appropriate in my view. But it's overblown. You know, I think it's overblown.
No, I just brought up the monetary reasons.
There was no incentive or any. There's no financial reward.
I remember I had started 12 games and I got a $250,000 bonus.
If you scored one touchdown.
No, if I
Yeah, that doesn't happen here.
Yeah,
we're not doing that.
And I said, I'm playing. I said, yeah. You shoot me up, whatever. I'm playing. I'm going to get that money.
So yeah.
That's why I said you get so.
I understand the question, but that's not part of the equation here.
The only thing that hasn't changed when it comes to potential offensive coordinator coming in the building, but were the moves that y'all made on the offensive side of the coaching staff yesterday the only moves that you intend to make at this time?
Yeah, I don't know that that's the case yet. You know, I'm not anticipating anything either way. Silly.
Is that, you say most people should be able to look beyond the results, but I mean, players have felt the effects of three losing seasons too, and you felt the need to have this talk with them after the season. Is that a danger with players not believing that this coaching staff will have the answers when you go through three losing seasons? I mean, is that something?
Yeah, I'm not worried about that.
Yeah, I mean, you feel confident that this team stayed.
Yeah. Look, I there's a lot of things about our team that I really, really like too, so. Look, I like that we played hard. I like that we finished 4 out of the last 5. Effort, you know, those kinds of things that happen in games. Even when things were going poorly, we're really good. Got a lot of, you know, I had a lot of individual talks with players, and I came away from those feeling really positive about a lot of things. Yeah, I think that remains to be seen.
Nick, how concerned you are with the future of Ryan Ramczyk, always one of the top linemen, and with his knee issue?
Yeah, I think, look, anytime you have a good player who's going through a tough thing health-wise, you're always concerned. And yet, you know, I have a positive feeling about where he's going to end up, and I think he does as well.
It's
different because the responsibilities are different. Particularly when you have a defensive head coach and you're looking for an offensive coordinator. Yeah, just no different than when Sean was a head coach and we went through searches for defensive coordinators. So, yeah, it's different.
What are you looking for in the next offensive coordinator? I mean, coming off of, part of the way is the guy that was around for 18 years gives you an opportunity to really know what it is that you like.
Yeah. Yeah, I think we have a set of criteria that a lot of different guys can fill. We're just kind of going through that process now, so I think I'll leave it at that.
How did you do Derek's first year?
Yeah, I think he did a lot of good things, and wasn't perfect for certain, but he did a lot of good things. And listen, I think that he was hurt for a good portion of this season, probably more so than he would let on or that was out there. So. I felt like he kind of hit a stride toward the end, and we did collectively too. So, and he's not the only player or position that was the case for.
Were you surprised how well Andrews played at left tackle? Because usually you don't talk about him and he's doing the job. I thought he was outstanding, considering that Manning's a guard and how he finished the whole season at left tackle.
Yeah, I would say yeah. He gets thrown back out there. And did a good job. He did. Really pleased with that. And I think that gives him some confidence as well.
Nicky, every offseason is a balancing act between putting together the best roster and staying fiscally responsible.
Yeah.
Do you ever get to the point where, when you're over the cap every offseason, where you look at it and say...
You mean like every year? You mean like every year? Yeah.
And maybe make some tough decisions with older players and count on our players' development and drafting and free agency and roll the dice a little, counting on younger people to evolve.
Yeah, I think we go through that process every year in the off season, and I've said this before is that we had kind of a vision and a plan for post Drew Brees. And then, COVID hits and we get this big setback relative to the cap and finances. And so that's caused us to recalibrate a little bit. But the answer to the question is yes, we do that. I'm not going to tell you what we're doing, but we do that. And we have, we have to make up some ground. There's no question, over a period of time here, we're going to have to make up some ground cap-wise. Yeah, it's just cap management. I don't want to get into the details of it.
But there wasn't a purpose to be like that.
Yeah, there's a purpose, but I'm not going to tell you what the purpose is.
Would it make it easier to trade?
It's just cap. It's just cap management. That's what it is.
Mickey, since 2017 draft was incredible, since then, how would you evaluate what you've done since then? And will you tweak your philosophy as far as the draft?
Yeah, look, I think a number of these drafts, the results have yet to be written. And look, 2017 was incredible, right? It I don't expect to duplicate that every year. I'd like to duplicate that every year, but don't have that expectation. So, no, I think our philosophies are sound, and I don't see that changing.
Yeah, I was just curious. It didn't come out yesterday, but maybe it wouldn't. Is anybody on the current staff up for the OC job? I mean, is that not?
Yeah, I'm going to keep that list to ourselves right now. But it'll, you know, those candidates will come out eventually.
How about with Coach Marone? A lot of fans have asked me, like, how he's developing the offensive line, and, you know, guys putting up their expectations. And, I mean, I don't know, just a rumor, like, oh, he might end up retiring. They're like, oh, the years that he's coach. So where do you think Coach Marone's at along with the offensive line right now?
Yeah, I think he's a fantastic coach. I do. And I haven't heard anything about him retiring, so that would be a surprise to me.
You mentioned some of the stats earlier about, like, maybe not paying attention to them. You've seen this league evolve over decades.
Yeah.
Where do you kind of, or how do you reconcile the data-driven analytics versus kind of that gut feel, so to say?
Yeah, that's a good question. Look, I think that analytics have been around a long, long time, way longer than we've been talking about them. They existed in 1983 when I started. We just didn't call them analytics. I think it's a tool in the toolbox, right? And you have to view it as such. And so I just look at it. And look, we got a lot more data, a lot more information than we did certainly then. And even in the last, you know, 3 or 4 years, we got a lot more data that we need to pay attention to. And so we do. But it's a tool in the toolbox. And there's still, you know, some of these analytics tell you to go for it on every fourth down, right? Well, what if you don't have a fourth down play that you like, right? What if you have a player that's injured at a particular position that's key to? So there's just a lot of factors and variables, and so I look at analytics as valuable, but a tool in the toolbox.
Can I ask, you just referenced 1983. People ask this question, you know, rumors get out there with social media and stuff like that. You've been doing this a long time. Your role is not changing here. You seem energetic about recalibrating the organization. The front office is staying the same as far as your
position. Yeah, I saw a couple things. That was just made up, whatever. I know what you're referencing. Somebody just made that up. That's never been discussed or talked about. Now, am I slower? Yeah, I probably ran a 4.5 when I was 30, and I don't think I could run 5 flat right now, so I am slower. But, yeah. You know, I've been asked that question. You get asked that when you get to a certain age, right, whatever age that is. And I've said, look, I'm just going to wake up one morning and say this is the day. And it's not going to be tomorrow, but everything for the next 10 years is open. We'll see. Yeah, I you know, I think the things that the head coach is responsible for, you know, game day management, scheduling, all the things that you guys don't see that I see or that we see internally, I feel good about. And, yeah, there's certainly areas that he can improve in. But, look, we've had a quarterback change. We've had, you know, some things changed in the last two or three years. And so we got to look at ourselves and say, okay, what's our expectations? Are they realistic? And if we're not meeting those expectations, what can we do differently? And I don't believe that that's the head coach right now. I think I like Dennis Allen. I think he's a good coach.
Offensive coordinator, do you share that with Derek Carr as far as his input and what he thinks? Or is it like, okay, you made the decision and then he has to accept it, or is he involved?
Yeah, we don't ask our players to make decisions. We don't. That's not a burden. That's not a burden that we put on them. Now, we talked to a lot of our veteran players about the season, about the things that we expect from them, and they should certainly have expectations from us, but we're not asking them to do any evaluations of any kind.
I mean, just to kind of rephrase that a little bit, well, Derek Carr, you know, whatever offense coordinator you go with, Derek's obviously got to be a big factor.
Well, look, when we make a hire, when Dennis makes a hire, certainly he's going to make the hire that'll work for him. But that'll be our assessment. That won't be We're not going to ask him if he approves it, of A, B, or C, right? Does that make sense?
When you guys do hire the OC, will the OC have input on some of the openings, like maybe guys that you would want to bring with them? How does that come?
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see where that goes.
If you do, and again, things that are out there, I know you can't talk about coaches, but John Gruden's name keeps popping up. How much of it has to be, you know him as a person, but knowing the situation and what happened and how he feels about it, just from a news perspective?
Yeah. Yeah, it's a fair question, but I don't really want to talk about any individual candidates for that role. It's a fair question, but yeah, we'll answer that when we hire.
How quickly do you expect that process to go? Is it one where you would like to take a little bit more time doing it, or is it going to take another rapid approach?
Yeah, I think, look, one of the mistakes that our league in general makes is, you know, we're in a rush and a race to hire people because we're afraid of, you know, someone else, you know, being us to the draw. I think that's a mistake. I think the most important thing is get the right guy in the right situation, take your time, make sure it's a thoughtful, planned decision. So we're gonna go through the process and we're gonna make the right hire. We're not gonna make the expedient hire. I don't know. We're going to have to restructure a lot of contracts.
Yeah. He, but for him too, I mean, like, in theory, if you don't, you could move on after. It just seems like with that one, there's a pretty big.
Yeah, well, that's all part of cap management that, you know, we've got to deal with. Yeah.
Taking your time, making sure you get the right.
So what's the question?
Is that something you view as a strength in terms of, you know, it's not necessarily, you know, just kind of fiddling your thumbs, like there's a process that you go through. And
yeah. I just think that you know, any decision of this magnitude, it just has to be a thoughtful, well thought out process, right? And you have to, you know, look, there's an obvious group of candidates, right? But there's another group of candidates that might not be quite so obvious that we need to make sure that we take a look at. And we'll do that.
Have you always been that deliberate, or is that something you learned?
I'm pretty deliberate. I've always been deliberate. I think that was one of Sean's complaints about me occasionally, is that I'm too deliberate and he's too impatient. So it was good. It was a good match, right?
You had a couple of people in your front office interview for the position. Yeah. Is that, are you kind of approaching that? Do you anticipate any changes?
Yeah, I don't know. Look, there, we got great candidates inside our building, Kai and Jeff and even Michael Parenton. And so we have some top flight executives in our building, and I'm rooting for them to get an opportunity. Although if they get one, I'll probably rue it, so. Yeah. They haven't yet.
If I can go back just to Pete for a second, obviously it's professional, but when you spend 18 years with somebody, there's a huge human component and personal relationship there.
Yes.
Not that I want like the full Pete behind the curtain, but like how emotional is that when you've been through so much with somebody?
Yeah, it's really emotional. Pete's he's a great coach, not a good coach. He's a great coach, and he's done, you know, I think, listen, we had historically good offenses here for a long period of time, and Pete was a much bigger part of that than he gets credit for. Really brilliant. You know, look, his first game as a play caller, I think we scored 60 points. So, it's emotional. And he's such a good person and such a great representative of the organization for all these years. And it was emotional for me, that's for sure. And it was emotional for a lot of people. By the way, I'm chewing this gum because I have a cough and it keeps me from coughing. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, they'll, I mean, again, that'll be a thoughtful, intentional process if one or both go. So, you know, no different than it was when Terry Fontenot went to Atlanta and Ryan Pace went to Chicago. And we've got, you know, great people behind, you know, those people too. So I'm really confident in the people we have in the building. And but that doesn't mean we won't look outside the building either. Yeah, I think it was, you know, a lot of good things, some ups and downs. Felt like we had some young players develop and improve. And, you know, I'm excited. I'm excited about the prospects for our defense. I really am. Yeah.
You have a lot of challenges going forward.
Yeah.
Including a 3-year drought from the playoffs.
Yeah.
How do you feel personally being the guy who's got to steward the organization through all of these challenges?
Yeah, look, I'm excited about it. I'm excited about the prospects of, you know, the guys that are on the team and their I'm excited about the willingness of all of our people, players, coaches, staff, to look inward and say, look, I've got to do better. Yeah, including me. And so that gets me fired up. Look, I hate doing these press conferences. You guys know that. So typically, I'm very stoic and unenthused, right? But I think we need enthusiasm. I think we need, you know, a boost in energy and excitement in our building. And so that, again, that, you know, all that stuff starts with me.
Can I go along, Chuck? Sorry, I interrupted you. You go ahead.
No, go ahead. Maybe, how much do you appreciate Ms. Gail Benson as an owner compared to maybe other owners around the NFL where they have no patience? And
yeah.
Whether it's the Eagles or Dallas or whatever the team might be.
You can name them all. I don't care.
But, I mean, you appreciate her ownership and how she has their trust.
Yeah. Yeah, I absolutely. We just have the best owner in sports. We just do. And I felt that way about Tom Benson, too. And Tom was more emotional. Bobby, you know that. And yet, man, he just gives us everything we need to be successful. So what, if we're not successful, it's not on her or it wasn't on him. It was on us. And that's all you can ask for in my role. And our coaches and our players, you know, it's never no when we need something to help us win. And so that's so valuable. It's hard to even describe. And we can look around at different franchises and different sports and say, ah, you know, the problem starts up here. Well, it doesn't start up here with our owner. She's fantastic.
Can I follow up on that? Just
yes. Yeah, that won't be an issue.
Okay. You talk about enthusiasm. What are your thoughts on some of those games for the fan base, you know, were booing or sold their tickets to fan bases? How do you get the fans back into it?
Well, you have to win. You have to perform well. That's on us, you know. And look, there's a little bit of a double-edged sword. You know, we just watched the Detroit Lions and their season and how fantastic that environment is and, you know, winning for the first time in a long time. We experienced that here, right? We experienced it in 06, 07, 08, 09. You raise the bar, right? We raise the bar. And that's a good thing. And so now that we've raised the bar, we got to meet it. And if we're not meeting it, that's on us. The only thing I really don't like is when we sell tickets to the opposing team and allow, you know, a big group in our building. And look, that's popular here because New Orleans is a destination, right? When our opponents look at their schedule and they see New Orleans, that's the trip I'm going on, right? We understand that. It's part of the deal, part about of being in a great city like New Orleans. So, but in terms of booing, the crowd reaction, that's on us. That's not on the fans. Look, if I was in the stands, there's a couple times I might have booed. I don't know.
Thank you. Back to the question I asked about the age. Obviously, that's 50-something divided by something, but very clearly some poor players
Yeah.
Are in their 30s. What does give you the confidence that this roster is strong enough in the guys in their 20s to maintain that?
DeMario Davis was all pro. He's 35 years old, 34 years old, you know. Cam Jordan basically played on one leg for more than half the season and was productive. And so, you know, age is a number. I get to say that because of my age. It's more about the performance. And I like some of these young guys that have come along, you know, Alante Taylor and Paulson Adebo and Carl Granderson. I mean, I can name a lot of players, Eric McCoy, the receivers that we have. There's a lot of really good things. And look, these guys, remember this around the league. These guys are under contract for generally three years, right? So it's not like you have them under contract for 15 years. You have them under contract for 3 years at a time, and then you make a decision. And so that's just our league. You know, that's what it's about. And so I'm comfortable with. I mean, I don't feel like we've got a particularly old team. And usually, I didn't see the one you're looking at, but usually the spread between the oldest and the youngest is like 12 months, 13 months. So it's not like it's, you know, we got a team that's got a bunch of 35-year-olds and another one that's got a bunch of 23-year-olds.
What you guys do up with, like, Trevor Penning not playing, Peyton Hurt, Turner being hurt, not playing, like, high-drafted guys?
Yeah. Yeah, it affects it. Listen, you can't, you know, these injuries are I don't want to say coincidental, that's the wrong word, but they're not controllable generally, you know. They happen. And look, yeah, I hate when it happens. And you know, Peyton, for example, was doing some really good things and got hurt again, you know. So that's tough, but it's not like he's trying to get hurt. You know, Trevor Penning's had a couple injuries that have slowed their development. And so that's different than misevaluating the talent. I don't know how to answer it otherwise.
Is Trevor like a point where you got a contingency plan maybe going forward because it is maybe a little uncertain, like that confidence level?
Well, look, we have a contingency. Excuse me. There's that cough. I mean, we have to have a contingency plan for everything. So. You know, injuries are indiscriminate.
Nicky, when you look at, like, last offseason, okay, we got to play better against the run. You have to be disappointed in that. Were you thinking interior defensive line, you know, game on your model, Lee, Shaitan, and everything? Seemed like we took a step back in that regard. We're basically giving up 4.5 yards a run.
Yeah.
And obviously not running the ball as well as we want. And that needs to be flipped, you know, as far as what we give up for.
Right. Yeah, I think you go into any season wanting to stop the run first, right, and then pass second generally. By the same token, you know, look, we wanted to improve in takeaways, right, in our takeaway turnover ratio. We did that. We weren't as good in the red zone on either side of the ball as we've been in the past, and yet I felt like, man, back half of the season we really improved in that area. Pretty significantly. So there's improvements that happen during the season, although the end result, the end statistic may not be where you want to be. So, you know, we're looking at all those areas and saying, okay, what did we do right? Why did we do that? And how can we improve on it? And then we're looking at the things that we didn't do well that we have to improve on if we expect to get the record and the results that we want. It's a good question, though. You know, we got to look at every one of those single areas and say, we weren't as good as we expected to be. Why?
What did you make of Michael Thomas this season?
Excuse me?
What did you make of Michael Thomas this season?
Look, I thought he was doing well and really excited about where he was. And then, look, we had another injury. It's really difficult for us and for Mike that you have to go through that. He's such a great competitor. So, you know, wants to win so badly, wants to be out there so badly and you know, for him to get hurt again was difficult.
And Nicky, with that being said, it seemed like the fans were led to believe, at least the last maybe couple of games, that Marshawn Lattimore and Michael Thomas would have been available.
Yeah.
If they
were available, they would have played.
Okay. I know what Dennis was asked this question. It's been a long time since we heard about a prominent player who at home in the Superdome. Do you think Derek went through was a little too much from the fans.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's the nature of the quarterback position, though, right? You get more credit than you probably deserve, and you get more blame. It's what I said at the beginning, is that the easy and lazy thing to do with results is to blame the coach or the quarterback. That's what fans do. That's what the media does. That's what, I mean, I hear ex-players doing it, so, and they don't really know, you know. Well, I think close is a I think we have the potential to be a really good team. Now, I thought that coming into the season as well. But there are some things that we have to do collectively and individually to get there. And actions are going to speak a lot louder than any words. So we'll see how this offseason goes. But, yes, I'm excited about the potential of our team. But we've got to do it. I mean, we've got to perform.
With Dennis, are there schematic things you've been impressed by during his tenure here?
Yeah. Dennis is a fantastic defensive coach. Fantastic.
Mickey, you referenced it again today, saying you have some ground to make up in the cap. You kind of said in years past you want to maybe look at how you're doing that.
Yeah. I don't know that change is the right word. We just got to be conscious of, making up some ground in the next few years. And there's different ways to do that. So, I've said this to you guys before. Sometimes you have to look beyond the numbers. And you have to look at, okay, how many guys are under contract? What's the roster? What are your core players? There's lots of different things to look at. You know, if you're $50 million over the cap and you have 30 players under contract, that's different than being $50 million over the cap and having 70 players under contract. So there's just a lot of different variables.
With Dennis, sorry if this is dumb, but, you listed off Belichick and the records there for the first two seasons. Does his Oakland experience just not matter at all? Because it would be.
Yeah, it matters.
If you throw that in, it would be year five rather than the first few years.
Yeah, it matters. It matters. You know, where you're at matters. The experience. Look, I think having any head coaching experience is valuable. You learn a lot of things, your first time around. Again, you have to look beyond just the record. You know, what was the circumstances when he was in Oakland? You know, they basically were way over the cap. They had to tear down the team. You know, the quarterback situation. There was a lot of variables there that, and he was given a short amount of time. So, you got to look at all those variables.
Have you ever felt the need to have a meeting with an entire team at the end of the season like you did this year? Has that ever happened before?
I've had meetings with the team before. It's been a while. But I felt like there were some things that needed to be said to the players. Just like I think there's things that need to be said to the coaching staff and to our football operations staff, and that's going to be said, Again, I think maybe we've gotten a little too comfortable over the last few years, and so I want to make it uncomfortable.
Mickey, how does that marry with, using that expression, we've gotten too comfortable, and also you guys made it very clear you didn't think the culture needed to change. You kept most of the staff after Sean left. What's the pros and cons of that?
Yeah, well, you're commingling terms. Cultures. Culture means a lot of things to a lot of different people. We've got great people in the building, so I want to make that really clear. We got really good guys, great representatives of the organization, hardworking. There's a lot of really good things, but there's some other things that I felt like, we need to clean up and that we've, I don't want to say slide, that's not the right word, but a few things that kind of had deteriorated over the last 4 or 5 years, kind of core beliefs. And again, that's my responsibility. That's why I spoke to the players. And look, DA spoke to the players as well. So It's not anything different in terms of what the head coach does. Well, look, last week is the first thing. I don't think you ever make really good decisions in the aftermath of a season when it's still emotional, right? So that's, we're giving the staff off, and everybody was really off the good part of last week. But it gives Dennis a chance to, get some thoughts, and me, and, it wasn't anything formal. Yeah.
I mean, since the offensive changes, does it feel like that is kind of one of the major things you've identified that could change the fortunes of this team?
Yeah, obviously. Yeah.
Like, is there the changes. One game this season that you look back and like maybe regret or think like that game could have changed the course of the season if you think back different?
Yeah. Yeah, there was a few things that happened that fourth quarter that were out of our control that I didn't like. That might have changed the outcome of that game. But there's always things. There's always a play here, a play there. It's a one game, right? And changes the entire course and narrative of the season.
When that's happening at the time, do you think that?
I do, because I've experienced it before.
Right. I don't know if it's that early in the season you think, oh, this will come back.
I said to someone, the last week we had to have certain things happen for us to get in the playoffs, right? We handled our part. But I've been in that situation in my career probably four or five times, and not one time has it ever happened like you wanted it to happen, right? So I hate getting to the point where you're relying on someone else to do their job for you or do our job for us. So we can't put ourselves in that situation. That's on us.
Then when you watch Tampa do what they did in the playoffs, does that add to another element of it? Or
yeah, yes. They played a great game and have become a good football team. They've won a lot of games in the last 6-7 weeks. It's a credit to them and a credit to their coaching staff and players.
Keep interrupting, sorry. When you say too comfortable and make it uncomfortable, when you have like a body of work like you do that combine the history, is that kind of like maybe in 08 when Garrett Gibbs left and Brett Williams got here in 13 when like Lance and Roman? Is that kind of what you're alluding to, that maybe a little bit of a change? Or is that just a parallel that I just kind of made up?
No, I think that's, there's some similarities there. Yeah, what's the old thing about keep doing the same things, the definition of insanity, right? So, yeah, we got to do things a little differently if we expect a different result. I'm trying not to talk about officiating, at least cryptically. I'm sorry, say that again.
From your experience, someone who went.
Yeah. Yes.
Basically, one of the most high profile mistakes, admitted mistakes. Where would you say generally, this is not about specific calls this year against your team or anything like that, but where would you say, how would you say you feel generally about the evolution of officiating since then to now? Is it disappointing or?
Man, I'm not going to comment on that, Brett. I'd like to, but I have some thoughts, and I've shared those with the league, and it's their responsibility, above my pay grade.
How critical do you think it is this year to finally fix and get back to the playoffs?
Yeah, look, I think every year is important to get back to the playoffs. That's the standard. That's the first standard, right, of a successful season, make the playoffs. And so if you don't make the playoffs, then I don't think you can say you've had a successful season. So we didn't have a successful season this year. We want to have a successful season next year. So, and we'll evaluate next season when next season's here.
The idea of a window, as you were kind of talking about earlier, do you guys internally see like that? You mentioned like player contracts in like 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
Like, do you guys view kind of a window to how this roster is built as
well or taking advantage of a window?
Well, I think you have to, I probably wouldn't describe it like that. I think you have to assess your team and have realistic expectations. But I think making the playoffs is a realistic expectation. I've said that was a realistic expectation this year. And so we're close, but not close enough. You want me to pull it for you? Good, Mike.
With Joel Thomas taking or headed to the Giants, first, was that a spot running back coach that y'all were considering making a change at already? And also, just what?
No, that was Joel's decision to, pursue that, and you'd have to ask him about the reasons behind that. But Joel's a fantastic coach, did a fantastic job. No, I don't feel that's fair to do. Look, when someone's been here for a good period of time and done a great job, they have the right to, self-determination. And so, generally speaking, that's how we approach it.
Nick, have you talked with Dennis about this, that you can watch a number of games, how you see poor tackling? And then how do you practice tackling?
Yeah.
Or did you see throughout the league?
Yeah. Look, that's a good question. I think that's one of the things that we need to assess is how are we approaching the off season? How are we approaching training camp? How are we approaching the preseason games? Because I felt like we got off to a really slow start in a number of those fundamental areas. And so is that a result of the way we're practicing? Is that a result of the way we play the preseason games? And look, it's hardest on your O-line, D-line, right? It's hardest on them because that's it's a contact sport in pads. And so what's the right amount of practice and preparation for those situations? Same thing with tackling, we don't do a lot of tackling in training camp or certainly in the preseason if you're not playing a lot. So these are all the things, look, I was telling someone, when I was in Seattle, 1983, we had 60 3-hour padded practices for training camp, something like that. Bobby, you experienced it. Now we have 17, and none of them are 3 hours. And so, look, it's a different amount of preparation. I'm not saying that was right to do it that way, but the preparation time is just different, and so we have to adjust to that. And I think that's a hard, really hard thing about coaching in this era of football is that do we have the right amount of time to get those fundamentals squared away and ready to go week one of the regular season? And look, I don't have the answers for it. I'm not a coach, so that's a coach's responsibility, but it's something that we need to talk about and examine. Are we preparing the right way? Relative to the rules that exist.
Does that examination include potentially how we count again for training camp, Greenbrier or something like that?
Sure, yeah. All of it's open for discussion, yes.
Mickey, as of right now, you only have 2 picks in the first 4 rounds, maybe a couple of picks coming your way. Is that an area maybe where you seek to add to that pool just to kind of help with the financial flexibility of the roster?
Yeah, sure, yeah. Yeah, because look, when you have a young player on a rookie contract, that's a different cost and cap than having a veteran player, so that it becomes part of the elements. But look, we want to put the best roster together that we can put together, and I always believe you can acquire players in all 3 forms, really: free agents, draft picks, trades. And so we're going to look at all those areas, and if we can improve our roster, that's what we'll do.
Nick, along the same lines as the question about practice and being able to practice, full contact and things like that. Cam Jordan talked the other day about the changes in the technology around the league and
yeah.
The convenience of being able to
study film at home.
Yeah.
But then the complications that come with that as well.
Right.
How would you measure sort of the technological advances of the league and balancing the conveniences, but also some of the problematic things? That
yeah, I think that's part of the equation, you know, is that look, when somebody wins a championship, right? One of the very first things you always hear is, "Man, we had great chemistry on our team. We loved each other. You know, we played for each other." There's a trust and a relationship, right? And yet, today we have, you know, and we're all guilty of it, particularly young people. You're at dinner and they're on their cell phone, right? They're on they're texting. They're not conversing and developing that relationship. And so I think that we have to be conscious of that. It's hard to develop chemistry and trust if you don't know your teammates well. And so, you know, in 15 years ago or 20 years ago, there'd be a group of guys in the position meeting room watching film together after practice, right? Bobby, I'm sure you did that with your receivers and some the other guys on your team, and you're conversing, you're watching the tape, you're watching your opponent, you're talking about it, you're sharing, you know, information. And today, you know, they go home with their iPad a lot of times and do that same study. So they're putting in work and effort, but it's just not the same. And so that's one of the challenges today. And so we have to, you know, have a right balance between the technology and then developing the relationships and trust.
The ability to maybe mandate certain things?
Not really. No. Well, you know, everything's voluntary these days, but here's what's mandatory is a commitment to winning, right? That's what's mandatory.
I was kind of curious about the same things he was asking. So it's basically asking the players to do extra, I guess. So you can't say you have to comment and do extra film study because they've already had their film study in their own meeting, right?
Yeah.
So does that fall to, like, the team captains to organize that or even leaders of specific groups or whatnot? Like, is that entirely a player-driven thing?
I think it's everybody. It's you know, what do you want out of your career? What do you want as a player, as a coach? Me, what do we want out of this? And it's what I said before, right? We all raise our hand when we say we want to win. And we all raise our hand and say we'll do whatever it takes to win. But then you have to do it, right? And a lot of these things that you're talking about, you have to do if you want to have a successful team. And so, yeah, it's simple as that, right? You know, you got to work on your craft. It's not a part-time career. You got to work on your craft, and you got to be thinking about that in some way, shape, or form 24/7. Especially if you don't think the other 31 teams are doing that. What gives you, you know, the NFL is so close. The margin for victory is so narrow. What are we doing differently? What are we doing better than everybody else? It's not just, hey, the roster's better. That didn't happen very often. It's the teams that do the things necessary to win, and there's lots of them. There's lots of things. Yeah, I look, we got a guy right back there who's done it, so ask him. But I think, Bobby, I see you nodding. I think you agree with me. Is it that there's things that you have to be committed to do? And it's, again, it's not mandatory things. There's not a consequence. There's not a consequence for not doing them. But here's the thing. Look, none of it's mandatory, right? And if we do every single thing, it doesn't guarantee that we're going to win. But if we don't, it kind of guarantees that you're not.
Nicky, how do you feel like, it seems like this is an NFL goal where we're at right now. You can look when there was over half the league. I mean, it might have been right under 20 teams, whatever. We did like 7 or 8 or 8-7.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have one that everybody looks at where the 49ers are at, and you look at the Ravens. But is that ideal? I mean,
because all the fan bases, everybody wants to win, everybody's not going to win. And it's every year at least 6, 7, 8 coaches get fired. And that's never going to change. Everybody wants to win. It's demanding. But you think that's good, the parity where everybody's hovering around 500?
Well, my perspective is a little different in that, look, I was in the league before free agency, you know, existed, right? So you'd build a good roster and a good team, and then you could keep it together for a long period of time. And if you built a really good roster and you weren't losing anybody, look, you had these teams that year in and year out for a good period of time were really good. And the rest of us are trying to catch up, right? Now it's just different in that it's hard to keep an entire squad, a good roster together for more than 3 or 4 years because of free agency. I think that's a good thing. I think every year, every city and every fan base wants to have the chance to win. And I think we have that in our league, and I think that's a good thing. But the result of that is that you have a few teams that haven't got their roster to the point where they can win yet. You've got a few teams at the very top that are really good, and then you've got the rest of us in the middle right now fighting to be, you know, 11-6 or 7-10. Yeah, right. So, and there's a lot of variables within that, right? Yeah, I look, we're the most popular sport for a reason. That's one of the reasons.
Kind of following up on that, can you explain just your personal philosophy or the way you look at it when you're constantly trying to be competitive every year instead of taking looking at like a hard reset, loading up, you know, and wanting to extend that kind of competitive.
I don't know if I can explain it.
Yeah,
you know,
I look at
things, you know, glass half full. I look at a roster and a team and say, man, if A, B, and C happen, we can be really good. And if it doesn't, or you have some injuries, or you know, you get some calls that don't go your way, then it goes the other direction. And look, we can point to these last three seasons, 9-8, 7-10. What was the year before? 9-8. And say, man, there were three games there that could have easily went the other way, and now we're talking about 12-win seasons, right? I think we've got a good roster. I do, and I think that, but we got to do some things better. I probably didn't answer the question, but all right, thank you, guys.